Bismillah, walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I am so grateful to Allah for all that He has given and blessed us with, and I pray to Him to bless, honor, and forgive His noble messengers, and we do not make any difference between any of His messengers. And also that He also be pleased with the righteous people and make us and our progeny of those people that He will allow entry into His gardens of Eden. As Allah says in Al-Quran, Jannatu Adn, gardens of Eden, i.e. gardens of eternity. يَدْخُلُونَهَا, they shall enter. وَمَنْ صَلَحَ مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ وَذُرِّيَّاتِهِمْ, and also whoever was good of their fathers, their spouses, and their descendants. وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يَدْخُلُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ, and the angels shall enter upon them from every gate, and the angels will say, سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا صَبَرْتُمْ, good for you, assalamu alaikum. And assalamu alaikum is not just a greeting. The angels are telling us we are at your service. And why is that service? Because of bima sabartum, for you patiently endured in this life of the world, and we did what Allah wanted us to do. And then the angels will tell us, فَنِعْمَ عُقْبَ الدَّارِ, what an excellent reward is this home of yours to be part of Jannatu Adn, the gardens of Eden. Amin, Rabbil Alameen. Every now and then the question about human circumcision comes up. One of such questions was asked the other day in the group, and the question was, I want to know if the circumcision is a fard, ordained or obligatory, or a sunnah, an act just ordained by the Messenger of Allah. And as I said before, a simple answer to this delicate or other questions isn't possible at all. I can't just say, oh, it's fard, oh, it's sunnah, and that's that. If you want to reach the truth that, and also be educated so that you don't keep always be in that state of confusion, you need to either make a research or look for a research and avoid at all costs singing the same old song that has been sung for the last 14 centuries that you already know the answer of. And also, you should not be one of those people that blindly follow and just keep doing what you have been doing, what your parents have been doing, what the community does, and what everyone else is doing. Because that is what Allah has warned us against, not to be of the majority, because the majority is always, always, always out of context. And also, you should not transmit something to your children based on just what you received from your parents, from what you are told. On Judgment Day, Allah will hold you responsible for how you interacted with the Quran. It's a personal choice. It's a personal matter. It's not a community matter. Now, let's go and find out the true ruling about this issue of circumcision. What I mean by that is, has Allah ordained us to circumcise our children or has He not? Furthermore, has Allah ordained that female also be circumcised or has He not? And to find the answer to these questions, we need to make the first stop at all cost at the first station, that is the Quran. When you look in the Quran, is that nowhere in the Quran does Allah ordain anyone to do circumcision, or as I would like to put it, mutilate the human body as a sign of obedience to Him. And this is a fact. So where does the custom of circumcision come from then? And this is where it gets very interesting. I'm going to start with the text used by those men of religion that have inflicted upon us the pains that millions upon millions of boys went through, are going right now through, and will go through in the future, including myself, the speaker. I still, to this day, can remember and relive vividly what happened over 50 years ago. That was the day when the scissors met what Allah created me with. The scissors that a man put on my body without any choice of mine, without me knowing what was going to happen to me, All that is because my parents believed that circumcision was an integral part of this Islam. I will tell you a little bit what happened on that day, so that you know every child that was circumcised and remember the incident will never, ever forget it. One day, I just woke up in the morning. My parents didn't tell me at all what was going to happen. Suddenly, a lot of people came and they were invited in the family, in the house, in the big house that we had. And people were taking extreme care of me. And I did not understand what was going on. They put henna on my hand. And they were all happy. And then they dressed me nicely. And they started giving me money. Still to this point, I've got no idea why is that. My birthday was not there. My birthday is in July. But the incident took place somewhere in August, past my July, my birthday, but anyhow. And then the food was nice, the singing was going on, and people were just taking good care of me. And I was asking about what was all this for? And they go, you have a surprise. Later in the afternoon, a man by the name of Mehrez, yes, Mehrez, like the football player, came to home. You see how I, after 50 years I still remember the. I don't remember any names of other doctors that throughout time took care of me in the hospital, either be of my motorbike accident or my karate accidents or whatever, all the accidents that I had in my life where I had to go to the hospital. I didn't remember, even when I went to the intensive care, the coma that I spent 11 days in. I woke up on all that kind of stuff. I don't remember all these names and all these fancy names, but I still remember the name of the man that one day traumatized me. Until today, I still remember his name. But anyhow, the man comes in the afternoon, and then I'm taken in the middle of a huge, big room. People were surrounding me from all angles, and they were singing, and I was totally confused. What was going on? They laid me back on my back. They laid me down on my back. And then I had my legs opened. And the guy came to me. When I saw the scissors, that's when I understood something was going to be taken away from me. And at that moment there, I thought to myself, Abdul Salam, this is not the time to coward. Be a man. That's what I thought to myself. At that moment there, I was 6 years of age. I was not. But anyhow, the man told me, look, there is a bird in the ceiling. And I told him, I know what you're going to do. Just do it. I'm not going to be afraid of you. And I looked what he did to me, how he pulled the foreskin and he cut with his scissors. The first shot, he didn't have the whole piece. And then he did the second one. And it's only after he finished the second one that I said, "Ay, that's all." And then he started applying all those disinfectants, and you can't imagine the amount of pain that I experienced that day. My physical body went through trauma. My emotional body went also through trauma. And then the next 3 months that followed was a living hell for me. Going to the toilet was a total pain. I could not sleep at night. And I was dressed in a girl's dress, but not a girl's dress, but like you see the Saudis people, how they dress in the white stuff, something like that. And I kept walking me holding that kameez or that dress in front of me so that it does not rub against what they have done to me. Never understood it, can never understand it until now. And just like an idiot, I went and did the same thing for my children, because at one point in my existence, somebody had told me that not being circumcised was not a good sign of a believing man. But anyhow, I apologize for this vivid description, but I wanted to tell you that the experience of circumcision marks a child for as long as that child lives. And as I said, I was 6 years of age. If you search our jurisprudence books of fiqh, or the man-made hadith, Bukhari and Muslim, all those things, you would find an incredible amount of texts and arguments And all, and I mean everyone of whatever has been and still is being said, is based on pure human speculations and texts that don't have any root in what Allah has sent down in the Quran, in the book of guidance, both to humans as a whole, and also contains laws to follow for those who choose to believe in the Quran. Nowhere in the Quran that Allah puts us through this traumatizing experience. But I'm going to go with you through the experiences that people believe in that made circumcision part of our creed, our Islam. The first of these circumcision evidence is what's reported in Al-Bukhari, who claims to have traced some statements to the Messenger of Allah, where he says that the Messenger of Allah said, five practices are characteristics of the fitra. When they mean fitra is what Allah has fatara you, i.e. what Allah has created us, that is the original traits and characteristics of Allah's creation. And they mention number one, circumcision. Number two, shaving the pubic hair, the region, the pubic in our genitalia. Three, shaving the armpits. Four, clipping the nails and cutting the mustache short. Subhanallah, these are the five characteristics of the fitra that are preached today. As usual, the man of religion entered a boxing ring to fire off this argument. So what they say, is it compulsory to circumcise, or is it just led to people's preference, or as they like to call it, sunnah? And I'll cover this later on in details. Those who said it is left to people's preference and for that is not compulsory, said that since clipping one's nails isn't compulsory, and neither is shaving one's armpit and shaving the pubic hair or shortening one's mustache, why would circumcision be any different? Would the other man of religion, the other party, accept this argument as a point of view and move on? Of course not. Absolutely not. They did everything in their powers to prove to the first group that their arguments are wrong and untrue. And for that, they traveled the world over, turning each and every stone and whatever they could find and put their hands in, even a little tray of something. They would bring it up and magnify it. And when they couldn't find those arguments to support their views, what they did, they twisted the argument, invented hadiths, made up rules and laws by which they bound everyone else. I make this law and this rule, and if you don't accept it, you are not a good Muslim. All was good to push their views. They had to be right. I'm not going to bore you with the countless texts that they mentioned before and that they invented to prove that circumcision didn't follow the same ruling as shaving the pubic hair and everything. So what they basically are saying is this: circumcision compulsory. The rest, okay, some of them say it's sunnah, some of them they say it's obligatory. Would you believe that? Would you believe that those men of religion say that shaving the pubic hair could be an act of sunnah? Or it's compulsory on you. If it's compulsory on us, why didn't the good God Allah mention that in the Quran? They don't understand this. But anyway, Allah in many ayat in the Quran would bring, this is what they say, that Allah in many ayat in the Quran would bring two things together where one is obligatory and the other is not. And for that they said, we apply the same technique here. So what they're saying is this: shaving the pubic hair, armpits, clipping nails and shortening the mustache aren't obligatory, but circumcision is. Well, go figure. Now, anyhow, this is how these monsters, and I call them monsters because they have changed the face of Allah's religion forever. Unless we go straight back to the Quran to recover Allah's religion, we will never ever live or experience Islam as Allah wanted it. Second point. Others said, no. You all got it wrong. Everything that is in the hadith is obligatory. So the other group, or the third group, they said, no. You, the first people that say just circumcision isn't obligatory, just like the others, and you guys who said circumcision is obligatory but the rest is not, both of you got it wrong. Because actually, everything is compulsory, from having the circumcision all the way to carrying the mustache. All of these to them are compulsory. And of course, you get tired. Wallahi, you get tired when you study all these arguments. Some well-respected Salafi men of religion, and also as people call them, the scholars or the sheikhs or whatever, with the name of Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi. This is one of the great Salafi sheikhs. He was born in the year 468, i.e. in the fifth century. This man lived in Spain and was a big follower of the Maliki school of thought. He is not the other Ibn Arabi, the great Sufi person. They are two different men, even though they were born in the same place, Spain, and pretty much around the same era, but they are two different men. Okay? But anyhow, so what did this man say? He says, وَالَّذِي عِنْدِي, in my opinion, إِنَّ الْخِصَالَ الْخَمْسَ الْمَذْكُورَ فِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ كُلُّهَا وَاجِبًا. The five acts mentioned in this hadith are all obligatory. فَإِنَّ الْمَرْأَ لَوْ تَرَكَهَا, if someone was to leave these five characteristics, لَمْ تَبْقَ صُورَتَهُ عَلَى صُورَةِ الْآدَمِينَ, his image or their image won't be of that of a human being. فَكَيْفَ مِنْ جُمْلَةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, much less that of a Muslim. So basically what this guy is saying is this. If someone does not circumcise, if someone does not shave their pubic hair, if someone doesn't that, then he is not a human being and cannot be considered that of a Muslim. And this is our problem. Just because one man decided out of his own head that in his opinion, he sees that whatever he sees was compulsory, someone else or his students or his school of thought liked what this guy said in his opinion was, and slowly things spread like fire until the believers' world today follows what this man in his opinion said. And this is crazy, it really is crazy. Because 99% of what Islam is today is what in someone else's opinion he thought was, people liked it, and it became religion. Now I go to argument number three. They also brought some other statements, and this one is really, really dangerous one too. They claim that the Messenger of Allah has said, and as is reported in Ahmad ibn Hanbal, in Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he says, مَنْ لَمْ يَأْخُدْ مِنْ شَارِبِهِ فَلَيْسَ مِنَّا, he who doesn't trim his mustache is not one of us. And this hadith, they say, is isnaduhu sahih, i.e. the chain of narrators is authentic. And this is absolutely crazy, because later on, when the Wahhabi state was very strong in Saudi Arabia, they used to have a Saudi law in the name of Islam. That law is still upheld today by Salafism, that anyone found with an untrimmed mustache would be and forcefully be made to trim it. They would make the person sit in the market with guards and spears on their heads, and somebody will trim their mustache, and it's still being done in Saudi Arabia today. There you see how these men of religion have abused their position and used their knowledge to kick people out of Allah's Islam just because they don't fancy trimming their mustache. If I don't want to shave my pubic hair, that's my business. That's my hygiene business. Why would you take me out of Islam like that? Allah didn't take me out of Islam just because I don't trim my nails or I don't do my mustache or I don't circumcise. Why would you do it? Well, that's how Islam is today. In the institutional Islam that was designed and invented by humans in the 3rd century, they believed back then, taught back then, and still teach today, that because of a hadith in Al-Bukhari that is about the five practices of the fitrah, and also because of Mr. Ibn al-Arabi, in his opinion, said, well, they have this ruling, and that's now, the scholars won't tell you this, but that's what pushes them to issue the rulings that they do today. They say, هذا الحديث, i.e. the five characteristics of the fitrah, this hadith, shows that trimming the mustache is obligatory. However, if one was to say that anyone who doesn't trim their mustache is making or committing a major sin that is not far from punishment. هذا الحديث يدل على أن الأخذ من الشارب واجب بل لو قيل إن من تركه مرتكب لكبيرة من كبائر الذنوب لم يكن بعيدا لهذا العقاب. Just like that. They decided whatever law they wanted, and then if someone doesn't do as they wish, and that person is actually eligible for their punishment. And so many people throughout the history of Islam, the last 1400 years, have been killed out of what humans thought in their opinion was al-Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear sisters and my brothers, has emphasized something, but sadly our brains don't think as Allah wants us to think. We always think when Allah talks about manipulation and falsifying the book of Allah, is only applies to the Jews and Christians. No. It also applies to us. What Allah is telling us, anyone who does as they did is actually guilty of the crime as they did, right? Well, it's simple. Well, here is, Allah says, من الذين هادوا يحرفون الكلمة عن مواضعه. This is in Surah An-Nisa, that is Surah number 4. Allah says, amongst those who have judaized, i.e. those who were with Moses and repented to Allah and accepted the condition of Allah as dictated in the Torah. Hadu is like Adu, those who came back to Allah. That's why the Yahud today are called Yahud, is because they went back to Allah. But anyhow, Allah says, there are some who displace words from their right place. Displacing words does not mean you change the order of the words, but you change the meanings of what Allah wants. What the scholars of the Jews did is what exactly has happened and is still being happening to our days and will carry on happening in the future. So as you can see here, just like that, if you don't trim your mustache, you are committing a major sin and punishment is yours. I'll go to number 4. Another piece of evidence they cling on to, and it's a very strange one indeed, it really is. And is they say that Allah's messenger Abraham was tested by Allah. And they say this, and this hadith is also in Al-Bukhari. They say, Abraham circumcised himself when he was 80 years of age. And because of that, circumcision is what Allah tested Abraham with. Just like that, out of their minds. Does Allah say this in the Quran? He doesn't. And for that, circumcision became part of Abraham's law, and Allah has ordered us to follow Abraham's law, and they used the following ayah, ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ. Then we have revealed to you, ya Muhammad, follow the way of Abraham. And this is in Surah An-Nahl, that is Surah number 16, the ayah 1, 2, 3. Their theory is that since Abraham did it, and Allah commanded and tested his messenger Abraham with it, and he ordered the Prophet Muhammad to follow Abraham, as such, we must do as Abraham did, circumcise. Then they mention another hadith reported again by Mr. Al-Bukhari and Muslim, in which these people claim that they traced a statement back to the Messenger of Allah, and as usual, it is Mr. Abu Huraira who reports this, that he heard it from the messenger. He said this, the hadith. Wallahi al-azim, it's incredible. He says, اختتنا إبراهيم عليه السلام. Abraham, they add, عليه السلام is not what the messenger say. It's what those people, the scholars say. Okay, but anyhow. وَهُوَ إِبْنُ ثَمَانِينَ سَنَ بِالْقَادُونَ. I.e. Abraham circumcised himself at the age of 80, and he did it with a small axe. There you go. That's their evidence. But what these people fail to realize is that the messenger of Allah is 100% innocent from such a lying statement. And that's because this story isn't the messenger's statement or a historical narration or anything, but it is the same story that is in the Bible, except the Bible does not specify the age. I'm going to mention to you some texts from the Bible, because in order for us to understand the circumcision topic, we need to trace its roots. Circumcision came into existence one day, and that day was unknown and still is unknown to humans. Let me ask you a question. What is the sin that has traveled with humanity throughout its history? You're going to say lion? I say no. Lion was invented at one point. You're going to say drinking alcohol? The same thing. At one point, humanity didn't know what alcohol was, what drug was, stealing, all that kind of stuff. The only sin that has traveled with humans throughout their history, since Allah decided one day to choose Adam from his brothers and sisters and make him the first for our kind, sex is always with humans. Because sex, you don't need anything. We are equipped with that. Okay, so circumcision was at one point in history a form of punishment. If someone was caught doing something with a woman, what would they do to the guy? Well, they would punish him. What's the punishment back then? Cut off his genitals? No, but cut in one piece and let him suffer or maybe die with it. That's how circumcision was invented at one point. But as usual, the Bible takes this circumcision and links it to what serves its purpose. This is why in the Bible, in Genesis, and that is in the Torah, Genesis 17 from verse 10 to 14, where Allah, this I'm going to read to you from the Bible. God told Abraham to circumcise himself, his household, and his slaves as an everlasting covenant in their flesh. Those who were not circumcised were to be cut off from their people. There you go. So this is where the Jews circumcise their kids. Because for the Jews, if you don't circumcise, you would be cut off from your people. You don't belong. And to a Jew, belonging is a huge problem. It's a priority. They live, they crave the belongings. Even though the Bible spoke about Abraham circumcising himself, it doesn't mention the age, at what age he did it. Some Christian artists drew the picture. If you go on the internet and you just type Abraham circumcision in the Bible and things like that, you will find some drawings of Abraham holding his genitalia and has some kind of an axe and putting it on a rock, and that's it. Go at it, Abraham, you're doing good. This is incredibly, I don't know what to say. Well, I don't know. So according to this biblical text, not everybody was to be circumcised. So who must be circumcised? The answer is then provided in the Bible itself, because Abraham, his descendants, and those who were bought with their money, slaves, they must be circumcised, and that is the problem. What this also means is that Abraham, his progeny from Isaac, Ishmael, and meaning all the Jews and their cousins, meaning the Arabs, their uncle Ishmael, also must be circumcised. And that's how we, I can't say the Arabs because I'm not an Arab, but because how the Arabs got the circumcision into their bloodstream. But this doesn't stop here, because since circumcision is a physical proof that sealed a covenant, of course, that's what they say, okay, because this is not true. The Quran completely negates this. But they say that there is a covenant between God and Abraham. And since the children of Israel have always claimed ownership of Abraham, they even say Abraham was a Jew. Allah has responded in the Quran, مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ يَهُودِيًّا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًّا. Abraham was not a Jew, neither was he a Christian, because Judaism came to exist with Moses, not with Abraham. So Abraham cannot be given to the Jews that he was from them. Absolutely not. But that's again the lie, the misplacing of words by the rabbi of back in time. Of course, the rabbi of now just following what's in their Torah. But anyhow, so the law they say has been injected is that circumcision is obligatory on anyone that wants to get close to the Jewish ritual, i.e. to worshiping Allah. Hence what the Bible says under the Passover restrictions. And this is again in Exodus 12, okay, chapter 12, from verse 43 to 49. And pay attention, because it's really what we are applying, Muslims or believers today, in our old habits they had, right? But anyhow, so we believers apply is what the Torah has taught or says. Listen to this. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, these are the regulations for the Passover meal. So Allah is going to set the regulations. Who can attend the Passover meal? He says, no foreigner may eat it. So if you are not a Jew, you're not going to do it. That's it. And then he says, any slave you have bought may eat it after you have circumcised him. La ilaha illallah. But a temporary resident or a hired worker may not eat it. It must be eaten inside the house. Take none of that meat outside the house. Do not break any of the bones. The whole community of Israel must celebrate it. A foreigner residing among you who wants to celebrate the Lord's Passover must have all the males in his household circumcised. Meaning, if say I am the one who wants to do circumcise, okay, I'm up for it. Circumcise me. No. We have to circumcise you. And then if I have five kids, then the boys, these five boys must also be circumcised. SubhanAllah, just like that. That's why it's extremely difficult becoming a Jew, because there are so many restrictions. One of them is any person that become a Jew within their lives, should they, I don't know by what miracle happens, guess what? If you are 90 years of age, off to the hospital you go, you must be circumcised. And this is exactly what we, the believers, do. If someone embraces Islam, guess where we send him? To the hospital. Go get circumcised. I have dealt with community problems for years, and I know many times I get this Muslim, it doesn't matter what she's from, she wants to marry an English person, and that's the big problem. He must circumcise or he doesn't marry you. Circumcision became, we became Jews. Actually, we are Jews disguised as believers. That's what we are. Therefore, all males of a household are to be circumcised if one of them want to join the Passover celebration. And this is the musketeer's law, one for all and all for one. It's funny. But anyhow, but as usual, when humans interfere with the divine text, my dear sisters and my brothers, calamities happen. Things get confusing and things go out of hand, and we find ourselves solving puzzles with so many missing pieces, because these pieces don't exist in the Quran. We can never ever close a puzzle. Here's how it happens. The laws commanding circumcision are said to come through Moses in the Torah. One of such examples is this. The Lord says to Musa, say to the Israelites, a woman who becomes pregnant and gives birth to a son will be ceremonially unclean for 7 days. And we Muslims or the believers, we make it 40 days. Just as she is unclean during her monthly period. So for the Jews, it's 7 for 7. And then it says on verse 3, on the 8th day, the boy is to be circumcised. And today, that's exactly what the believers do. They want to celebrate. You get this idea, when should I circumcise my kid? What day? 7, 8? Well, become a Jew because you're doing just what the Bible says. And also, all those who came out of Egypt, this is in Joshua chapter 5 and verse from 4 to 7, all those who came out of Egypt, all the men of military age, i.e. those who can fight, died in the wilderness on the way after leaving Egypt. All the people that came out had been circumcised, but all the people born in the wilderness during the journey from Egypt had not. So basically what this is saying is this, that the law of circumcision was abandoned at the time of Moses, because when the Jews were in Egypt, all of them circumcised. But when the people were in the wilderness, in the 40 years of the wilderness, 40 years the Jews just in the wilderness, okay, as a punishment from Allah, those generations that were born in the wilderness were not circumcised. And like that, Musa had not circumcised his own son. And according to the Torah, Musa was the first disobedient of Allah's law that he made the covenant with Abraham. Of course, but anyhow, I'm telling you what's in the Bible, because in the Quran it's completely different. The Bible says that God was absolutely angry with Moses, and Allah wanted to kill Moses. But the wife of Moses did something, and the Bible says that God spared the life of Musa just for what his wife did. This is in Exodus chapter 4 from verse 24 to 26. Listen to this. The Lord met him, i.e. the Lord, Allah met with Musa, and sought his death. Allah wanted to kill Musa. Then Zipporah, and Zipporah is the wife of Musa, took a rock and cut off her son's foreskin. There and then, when she saw that Allah wanted to kill Musa, before Allah got to Musa to kill him, she was very smart, took a rock, and suddenly, I don't know how she did it. Did she keep banging the foreskin of the kid with the rock until, do you see how cruel that is? I want you just to imagine in your mind, how did this woman with a rock just took off the foreskin of a boy's private part? How? I don't know, but anyhow, this is what it says in the Bible, okay? And because she cut off the foreskin and touched the feet of Musa, and she said to Allah, this is because you are a bridegroom of blood to me, or my husband. So he, the Lord, let him alone. So Allah, then when he saw what the wife has done, quit wanting to kill Musa. At that time, she said, Zipporah, the wife of Musa, you a bridegroom of blood because of the circumcision. In other words, the standard interpretation of the passage is that God wanted to kill Moses for that Moses neglecting the rite of circumcision of his son. Zipporah averted the disaster by reacting quickly, and she did what? Performed the rite of circumcision, thus saving her husband from God's anger. And this is in the book of Talmud, Shemot Rabbah, and from chapter 5, verse 8. So as you can see, at first, all the children of Israel were left, those who left Egypt were circumcised. Then those who were born in the wilderness weren't, and Allah got angry with Musa, and you know the story. From that, Musa was given the command to circumcise from the Lord himself, they say, because Musa had disobeyed, and then Allah commands Musa directly, you gotta circumcise whoever is in their wilderness with you, and then anyone that comes after that. My dear sisters and my brothers, notice, there is a strong connection between circumcision and slavery. Anyone who is owned by a Jew for the Passover, if that person wants to eat from a Jew, must be circumcised. For Abraham, remember what the good God told him? That he must circumcise himself, his household, and his slaves as an everlasting person. So the slaves at that moment there had also no say whatsoever. This is a problem that we are experiencing today, because the law of slaves and everything that was in the Torah were taken and put into Islam under the title of jurisprudence, and that is a huge problem. For the Jews, circumcision is a matter of belonging or not belonging. Again, for the children of Israel, being circumcised meaning you have a people you belong to, just like us, the believers. Imagine if your family, your community knew that you were not circumcised, they will shun you, they will just ignore you, they will just reject you. Wallahi, they will reject you. Imagine if you're gonna marry a believing woman and she finds out you are not circumcised. What is your reaction? I'm asking you, my sisters, I'm asking you, my brother who's listening to my talk, if someone came to ask for the hand of your daughter and he is not circumcised, but he's always been a believer, how are you gonna feel? You're gonna feel like it's no big deal, or is it gonna work on your subconscious? Well, you'll see. I don't, but anyhow, they say that in the Torah there is a teaching that says the following. This is again in Genesis 17 from 10 to 14. I'm gonna just read it straight through. This is my covenant, says Allah, which you shall keep between me and your offspring after you. Talking to who? To Abraham. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. He who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised. Every male throughout your generations, whether born in your house or bought with your money from any foreigner who is not of your offspring, both he who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money shall surely be circumcised. So shall my covenant be in your flesh, an everlasting covenant. Any circumcised male who is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin shall be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant. And it's incredible. And it seems that we, the believers, are following suit. We have turned something that is not ours and said anyone who is not circumcised is not a believer. And this is really, really spooky and extremely, extremely scary. Add to that, according to the Hebrew Bible, conversion to Judaism is for non-Israelites requires circumcision, as I said before. But anyhow, they say that Allah had put Abraham to a test. وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَ. And they say, and remember when Abraham was tried by his Lord with certain commands, and Abraham fulfilled this command. And this is in Al-Baqarah, that is Surah 2, and the ayah is 1 to 4. My dear sisters and my brothers, it's given me a headache just telling you what I have found. But I'm going to say this. To further reinforce their arguments and make them valid, they mention some statements and they say that Abdullah ibn Abbas, when commenting on the above ayah, وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَةٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ, and remember that Abraham was tried by his Lord with certain commands and he fulfilled them. They say that Abdullah ibn Abbas said that Allah put Abraham through a test ordering him to purify himself five times in his head and five times on his body. They said the five things that Allah commanded Abraham or tested him with in the head was trim his mustache, gargling water in his mouth, sniffing water into his nose, usage of siwak, splitting hair from the middle in the hair, even the hairstyle of Ibrahim. It's funny, qasam billah, it's funny. So they say Allah put Abraham to a test. And what for the test is that Ibrahim must follow the haircut that Allah tells him. And that haircut is to split hair in the middle. So I'm sorry for this, but you see how funny it is, how the lies are. But this is what our scholars learn, and this is what they preach, and that's how they tell us what to do, because they read texts like this. But anyhow, so, and as for the five tests in the body was nail cutting, shaving of pubic hair, circumcision, unrooting of hair from the armpits, washing his private parts wherever he goes for peeping or pooping, he must wash himself. And they say this hadith is also authentic chain of narrators. And you can find this in the books of Tafsir of Tabari and all that kind of stuff. But you can see the joke about what they call hadith and what they call Abdullah ibn Abbas. It's actually a huge, big, funny joke. But anyhow, just for information, any man-made hadith that says that the chain of narrators is authentic does not necessarily mean that the text itself is authentic. All it means is that what those people that looked into the life of the biographies of other people saying is that those people are reliable and trustworthy. That's all. They don't say that what they said is true. I'll give you an example. Reuters, the media mogul, the big media, is a reputable source, right? So when they mention something, the Reuters themselves are reliable, but the news itself could be or could not be. So exactly, that's exactly how it happened. But anyhow, that's the Jew. So for every Jew, they must circumcise. What about Christianity? Well, Christians, as we know, the Torah mentioned that Abraham circumcised himself at an advanced age and also circumcised his children. And for that, he honored the covenant between himself and Allah. And for this, circumcision is clearly defined as a covenant between God and all Jewish male. That's how they put it. In Christianity, however, circumcision is not laid down as a requirement in the New Testament. Instead, Christians are urged to be circumcised of the heart, not the private parts. And since Jesus, son of Mary, was a Jew himself, the Bible says that he also was circumcised on day 8, just like his people. But Allah completely ignored this piece of information because it's irrelevant. To Allah, it has no meaning whatsoever. Ever, because to Allah there is no covenant between him and Abraham and the offspring that come after him. The Bible says in Luke chapter 2 verse 21, and when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus. which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. So basically what they say, that Jesus was circumcised on the day 8, and the name came from the angel Jibril alayhi salam. So it's a name from Allah. The New Testament, however, tells Christians that they are no longer under any obligation of that of the Old Testament law, and circumcision is no longer required for them. I will just mention one passage from the Bible to bring this matter to light and why Christians do not circumcise. And again, Corinthians 1, because there are two Corinthians letters that Paul wrote, but this is Corinthians 1, and that is chapter 7, from verse 17 to 20. Here is what it says. Was anyone at the time of his call already circumcised? Let him not seek to remove the mark of circumcision. So if you are circumcised, well, don't do anything about it. Was anyone at the time of his call, i.e. Jesus, uncircumcised? Let him not seek circumcision. For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but keeping the commands of God. Each one should remain in the condition in which he was called, and that is called by the message of Jesus. Basically, what the New Testament, the Bible says, that whatever way you find yourself in when you accept the message of Jesus, the gospel, and you become Christian, remain as you are. If you are circumcised, don't do nothing about it. If you are not circumcised, stay as you are and don't do anything about it. We accept you as you are. We, the believers, we should have gone that route as well, but we follow the laws of the Torah. And this is what I have mentioned. It is clear that circumcision started not with Abraham, and it did end with Jesus, and later on was not revived by the Prophet Muhammad. Allah did not command us to circumcise ourselves. And I will get back to this later on. As the New Testament has its circumcision itself, or the old one, is a covenant, but the New Testament, or the one that came after the Old Testament, makes it not. And as such, the children of Israel, or those who follow Christianity, are not obliged to circumcise. Why weren't they included in this covenant in some manner? Why does it have to be man alone to get circumcised? Furthermore, the Bible that is today with us is only a translation from the Latin, and from the Latin to Old English, and then from Old English to the English of today, and then each year they keep revising it, right? A lot can get lost in translation. And the same thing for the Quran that they translate into English. There is tons of misinformation that is not in the Arabic, but exists in the English. And this is the problem that we face today, when people that don't read Arabic read only the English translations end up with a lot of misconception. The question to ask here is really this. Did Allah truly command circumcision as a proof for the covenant between Him, the Holy Self of Allah, and Abraham or not? If He did, why wasn't it then mentioned in the Quran? The Quran is the last update of Islam, and circumcision does not exist in the Quran. It is well known fact that circumcision didn't start with the patriarch Abraham. And as I said before, it started at one a form of punishment in the dawn of humanity. And Abraham was just a product or a produce of his own people. Humanity circumcised way before Abraham, so it's not something just relevant to Abraham. He's not the inventor, he's not the guy who made it happen, Abraham. It was well before. He cannot be credited for being the first to have circumcised, as because that is not true. The Bible claims, anyhow, the idea of the male circumcision stinks because once again it elevates the male high, way high above the female. When Allah takes a covenant from a people, Allah takes it equally from men and women. In the sight of Allah, there is no gender distinction whatsoever. Allah says in the Quran, "Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum." The most honorable, the most respected, the most loved, the most everything you put of good behind that most in the sight of Allah is when a person is pious. How pious you are, that's what makes you. None of us humans existing on earth today can be more pious than Miriam. So in the sight of Allah, Maryam is more in high status than any man that lived after her, except those messengers. Other than messengers, no one can beat Maryam in piety. And she is a woman. So if circumcision was a proof of the covenant of Allah imposed on Abraham, why aren't women directly talked to by Allah? But anyhow, and also comes the 8-day circumcision time gap. A lot of people think that if you circumcise a kid at a very early stage, then the pain isn't as intense as when done later on. But this is not true. The child will feel pain and a lot of it, but the poor baby just doesn't have a way to express that pain except by crying. The injury will heal a lot quicker, that's true. But the pain nonetheless still lingers on. So why is it the removing of the foreskin that important? Has Allah made an error when he designed us, the human body? If the foreskin is will harm the male, and this defect in creation, so why did Allah create it in the first place? Why? This is a question that has to be asked. If Allah has created me with a special skin to protect my genitals, then why remove it? Especially that the removal has nothing to do with sex or cleanliness, but rather because of some sort of a covenant that we know nothing of. The foreskin, my dear sisters and my brothers, protected us when we were inside our mother wombs, and protected us when we were little and when we used to play, and will carry on protecting us just like any other part of the body. Cleanliness and hygiene is highly a must, just like you would clean your hand, just like you would clean your face, your nose. I don't know what you're cleaning your body, right? Well, then the foreskin gets cleaned like that, and it's not a source of bacteria. Just it's incredible. Today we wear underwear. If you smell your underwear, you will just like puke, right? Well, guess what? Because that's how Allah created us. So the foreskin is not the source of absence of hygiene or dirtiness or uncleanliness. It's just something that Allah created, and he created it for a purpose. And that purpose was taken away because of customs from us. I'm going to mention now the Quran view on circumcision. I wanted to say what Islam's view, but then again, Islam is the religion of all messengers from Adam alayhi salam and any human that existed until the end of time. Allah has only one religion, and that religion is al-Islam. The Jews are Muslims, but they have their own law that they follow. وَلِكُلِّنْ جَعَلْنَا شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجٍ. And each of you, Jews, Christians, and everyone, Allah has made for us a set of law and a way of life in that religion. And Allah on Judgment Day will hold the Jews responsible based on the Torah, and the Christians based on the Gospel, and us based on the Quran, and so on and so forth. So, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has one religion, and the final upgrade of that religion is Al-Quran, and it doesn't have anything that mentions circumcision, so then the big question that we ask here is, why is circumcision an integral part of who we are as believers in our day and age, especially that no one in the Quran does Allah mention or refers to male circumcision, and not from near and not from far. And as for the female circumcision, it's impossible to find any reference whatsoever. Already the male, there is no reference. So for the female, it's above impossible. And because there is nothing from the Quran, the matter should have ended there. You see, when the Prophet Muhammad came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not ask anyone, who of you, my followers, is circumcised? Who is? He never asked. Because if circumcision was important, Allah would have commanded the messenger to ask people who of his companions was not circumcised. And if he was not, he would have commanded him to go and circumcise himself. He never ever ask that. The Prophet Muhammad was a producer of his own people. Quraysh, the Arabs, were not people to circumcise. Some of them did, those who followed the law of Ibrahim did. But the pagans and the rest of them, many of them didn't. Always remember this. And again, to cut some pathways. I'm noticing the time here is getting to the hour, so I'm going to stop here and I will carry on part two, and I will talk back on the one on the female circumcision. I pray to Allah to bless us all. Assalamu alaikum, and I see you in part two. Assalamu alaikum.